Hachette Audio presents The Gates of Gaza, a story of betrayal, survival, and hope in Israel's borderlands. Written and read by Amir Tibon. Chapter 1. They are here. 6:29 a.m. October 7, 2023. At first, there was only a whistle. A short, loud shriek coming through our bedroom window, indicating the descent of a mortar from the skies above our house. I didn't wake up immediately. The noise, otherworldly but familiar, somehow blended into my dreams. Miri, my wife, was quicker to realize the danger. "Amir, wake up, a mortar," she said, elbowing me. In an instant, I was wide awake, adrenaline pumping. We both leapt out of bed and, wearing only our underwear, frantically sprinted out of our bedroom and down the hall toward the open doorway of our safe room. 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds. We reached the room and shut its heavy iron door. No sooner were we enveloped in darkness than a large explosion rocked the building. We had made it just in time. That first explosion was followed by a second and a third, and then more and more. It was a barrage of mortars, a heavy, deadly rain falling all around us. "Did you hear an alarm?" I asked Miri, whispering into the void of the blacked-out room. "I just heard it about to fall. That's what woke me up," she replied. There had been no siren, nothing to warn us but the whistle. We were beginning to catch our breath. But as we did, we felt the vibration of another explosion nearby, and then another. I looked at my blue Trojan watch and saw that it had now been 5 minutes since we ran to the room, and the bombardment hadn't let up. For the first time since we'd sprung out of bed, I looked at my phone, which I'd brought with me from the bedroom. I wanted to know what was happening in our community, in our broader region, in our country. Clearly, something unusual was going on. We were surprised and disoriented, but not fearful. Certainly not panicked. Not yet. As residents of Nahal Oz, a small community of just over 400 people located on the Israeli border with the Gaza Strip, we had experienced situations like this before. Nahal Oz, which was founded in the early 1950s, is less than a mile from the border fence, making it officially the closest Israeli community to the Palestinian coastal enclave that runs along the Mediterranean Sea. Nahal Oz is surrounded by green fields and natural beauty, but in recent decades, it has become one of the most bombarded places in Israel, as terror groups from Gaza have launched thousands of rockets at it. When you live here, occasional rocket or mortar fire is something you grow used to. Unlike most of Israel, which is covered by the Iron Dome missile defense system, Nahal Oz doesn't enjoy such protection. It is so close to Gaza that the system's automatic interception hardware doesn't have enough time to calculate the route of an incoming mortar. In every home in Nahal Oz and in other Israeli communities along the Gaza border, there is a special room, an above-ground bunker built of thick concrete that is supposed to withstand a direct hit from mortars and even from certain types of stronger, heavier rockets. This room, the safe room that we ran into that morning, also has a metal plate that can cover the window and prevent shrapnel from flying in, as well as a shrapnel-proof door that serves the same purpose. This standard-issue safe room has a clear security function, but most families on the border use it for another purpose. This is where our children go to sleep at night. Nahal Oz is so close to Gaza that when a mortar is launched toward the community, you have only 7 seconds to take shelter. When you're inside the house, that means running to the safe room and shutting the door. For families with small children, the choice is clear. If there's a mortar attack during the night or early in the morning, it's much better for the parents to run to the children's room then the other way around. So far, our two daughters seemed undisturbed by all of the drama. Galia, a blonde-haired, blue-eyed 3.5-year-old, was dozing peacefully, still hugging her favorite doll. Her little sister Carmel, 1 year and 9 months old, briefly raised her head and glanced at us with sleepy green eyes when we'd first dashed into her room, but then found her pacifier and returned to her dreams. This wasn't the first time they had experienced this kind of situation, their parents running into their bedroom as explosions mounted in the background. We never made a big deal out of it, so neither did they. It was part of our lives and theirs, a frenzied but familiar routine in Israel's borderlands. As the mortars kept falling around us, we felt safe inside the room, with its heavy door locked and its only window sealed with a solid metal plate. This was a simple square of iron, the exact same size as the concrete aperture, attached to the wall with hinges. We typically kept it pulled back from the window, since we wanted our girls to be able to enjoy sunlight and fresh air in their bedroom. But in times of need, it could be rolled shut to cover the window within seconds, as we had done upon entering the room this morning. With the door closed and the plate covering the window, it was pitch black inside the room. But we used our phones for light and now settled onto the floor to wait out the bombardment. As soon as we had done so, however, we read on our phones that Hamas, the Palestinian terror group controlling Gaza, had not just attacked our community, but also fired mortars and rockets at dozens of other places across Israel. We hoped that the girls would continue to sleep peacefully in their beds for a little longer, but we knew that for us, the night was over. We had to start packing. I had first visited Nahal Oz 9 years earlier, in August 2014. Israel and Hamas, which had taken control of Gaza 7 years earlier, were fighting a long, bloody war that summer, and I had driven down to the Gaza border area from Tel Aviv, where I lived back then, to report on the hostilities. In my work as a journalist, I had previously covered wars in Syria, Ukraine, and Iraq's Kurdish autonomous region. It was discomforting to witness the widespread devastation of a major conflict only an hour's drive from my home in central Israel. Ahead of my arrival at Nahal Oz, a friend in the news industry had given me the phone number of a man named Itai Maoz. He was a farmer in his early 50s who had stayed in Nahal Oz that summer despite the heavy bombardment, and he was willing to give me a guided tour of the place. Most of the residents had been evacuated to other parts of Israel because of the war with Hamas. So when I met Itai, a bald man with a soft smile, and he began showing me around, I found myself walking through a ghost town. Nahal Oz has agricultural lands that literally touch the Gaza border fence. And ever since the community's creation, taking care of those fields has been an abiding commitment for the people living here. The land is plowed all the way up to the edge, the last furrow lying just meters away from Gaza. These fields are usually a beautiful sight, but when we first went out to them that day, I saw them in a different light. They were completely destroyed after the Israeli military had turned them into a parking lot for tanks. An orchard had been crushed by the military vehicles, water irrigation systems were badly damaged, and the countryside was littered with waste, ranging from shell casings to discarded food wrappers. Itai told me that he wasn't angry at the soldiers who had destroyed the fields. They didn't really have a choice, he explained. I was surprised to hear that he also felt no anger toward the people of Gaza, even in the midst of the fighting. I'm obviously angry at Hamas for shooting at us, but I'm not angry at the average Palestinian living in Gaza, he explained. They suffer from this war just as much as we do. Personally, I shared Itai's sympathy for the civilians in Gaza, but I was an outside observer. Here, by contrast, was someone on the front lines who still showed empathy and compassion for the people on the literal other side, even after weeks of continued bombardment of his community. I knew that Nahal Oz, like many communities along the Gaza border, had a strong left-wing liberal political leaning, and that residents of the border area are some of the strongest advocates of Israeli-Palestinian peace. Still, the calm tone in which Itai discussed his views of Gaza resonated with me and left a deep impression. When I got back to Tel Aviv that evening, I couldn't stop talking about my visit to Nahal Oz and how struck I was by the beauty of the place and the strength of its people. I told Miri, then my girlfriend.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.